The next speaker is Mustafa Sagizly, if I pronounce it right. He is the He is the director of the Warriors Affairs Committee of Mission of Libya. While talking peace, many of you might have heard the recent news of new waves of violence in Libya. And how to turn that violence into a more peaceful, stable country is the question, Mustafa. The floor is yours.
Thank you, everybody. As you might have heard, Libya had a revolution in 2011, on the 17th of February. The Libyan people, for 42 years, were led by a dictatorship, where we had a dictator. We are an oil-producing country, oil and gas-producing country. We have a small population of around 6 million. With a great location on the Mediterranean and north of Africa, close to the south of Europe. But unfortunately, for 42 years, we had a dictatorship where most of our resources were spent on the dreams and the fantasies of the dictator who's Gaddafi. I was one of the people who participated in the revolution, and our revolution was basically because of two causes. One of them was we seeked freedom because we were under a dictatorship and we wanted to be free. It was a one man, one family rule. And the second cause is that we wanted development, we wanted opportunities, we wanted to live a decent, prosperous life. So most of the Libyan people revolted against this dictatorship. And in the first days, it was peaceful demonstrations. But then we were attacked by Gaddafi's army and his security brigades, so we had to carry our arms to defend ourselves and to defend our country and to gain our freedom. I was originally a businessman, a computer engineer. I had my own company, but then I became a commander, a fighter, a commander of a brigade. I had never carried weapons before, but we had to defend our people, so we trained, and we trained young people to carry weapons to defend our cities and our freed areas. This led to the situation where, after we gained our victory and we freed our country from the dictator, we had to bring back these young people who carried arms back to their normal life, and not only to their normal life, but to participate in rebuilding the state and in developing the country. So myself and a few of my colleagues who were leading the fighters, we decided that we had a duty to bring them back to normal life and help them to be part of rebuilding Libya. I remember when we used to give them weapons and arms, we used to register the serial number of the gun, thinking that one day we would be able just to get it back. But after the revolution and the fight finished, it was impossible just to call them back and tell them, okay, bring back your arms and go to your normal life. There was also a problem where many of these young people did not have jobs. And even the ones who had jobs, it was just a salary by the government, a small salary that would not give them a good life. This is the background. We established the Warriors Affairs Commission. We chose the name Warriors because right after the revolution, these fighters were very proud, and we wanted to bring them in a body that can absorb them and plan for them and develop programs for them. The goal of this commission was to register them, have programs to rehabilitate them and reintegrate them from former thuwar, what we call thuwar or revolutionaries, to people who can participate in rebuilding the state. We thought the best way to do this is by having branches all over Libya to register them and to get to know them and to interview them. As you can see, Libya is a big country on the Mediterranean and also in the Sub-Sahara. So we established 30 branches in all of Libya. We put the criteria or the definition of the Thuwar who will be registered, and basically they are the ones who participated in the revolution and carried their weapons. Our mission is to support them to reintegrate in society again, plan and establish the programs and design the programs, which is really, as you have mentioned, designing a program is something, one of the biggest challenges, especially in post-conflict and in situations like the situation of Libya, where we don't really have institutions. We had a family or a dictator leading the country. All decisions were made by him. He left no parliament, no ministries. We need to build the capacity of the country. So designing such a program needs a lot of capacity, needs flexibility as things keep on changing. And our objectives in general, it is DDR, but we thought that for Libya it would not be DDR suitable. DDR, that is disarming, demobilization, and reintegration. In the case of Libya, these young people, you can never just tell them, okay, give me back your arm and I will reintegrate you. Because most of them held their arms because they were fighting for a goal, for the liberty, development of their countries. So we thought that reintegration and giving them opportunity should come first. Reintegration that would lead to demobilization and eventually would lead to disarmament. We thought that we cannot just disarm, take the arm from a young man who fought for his country, but we can take him from arms. And the best way to take him from arms is to give him an opportunity of education or an opportunity for a small business. This is the operational plan. So I have somebody that can audit it and test it for us. This is registration. We started first in verification. Profiling, we interviewed more than 165,000 of these armed people. Then we had an awareness and educational program. Awareness is very important because you have to change the mindset of the fighter or the ex-combatant to make him recognize that the time of carrying the arms has passed and now it's the time to participate in building his country that he fought for. And then the fourth phase is the reintegration and follow-up, and that is the reintegration program, which I think around 45% of the registered in our program have chosen SMEs and entrepreneurship as their opportunity. Reintegration, we have divided it into four categories: social, political, economic, and educational. Social is very important, especially psychological support for these young people, because many of them carried arms from a civilian background. Political reintegration is important because in order to demobilize militias, you need to give them, they have their political ambitions and they have their vision for the country. So it is very important to move them to the civil side where they can have their own organization, their own party to participate in rebuilding the state. Economic reintegration, that is SMEs, vocational training, and we have the career centers. SMEs and entrepreneurship, in our case, is crucial because the government, the previous government, turned the country into a socialist country. Even though the population is small, it's a very rich country. And most of the economy is led by the public sector and the government, more than 90%. Now it is very important to change it, so the numbers will change. It should be more than 80% or so for the private sector to give them opportunities to finance them and to diversify the economy. We have a problem of capacity, so we thought it's very important to have a vocational training program, because many of these people did not get an educational, good educational opportunity. For example, there was a law by Gaddafi for the last 20 years that abandoned teaching English in school, which is something we need to solve, and we need to have English language campaigns and IT campaigns and so on. Campaigns are not long-term. Long-term will go on, but we need to do it now. And education, of course, we have two programs, the higher education program and the vocational and the English language program. Coming to SMEs, and I would like to maybe close with the SMEs, we have more than 67,000 who are interested and have chosen the opportunity of having their own small businesses. Some of them are employed in the government, some of them are jobless, they don't have any employment, and some of them have their own small business that they would like to expand. Planning for such a large number is a big challenge. Opportunities are there in Libya in all sectors, as it is a country that needs to be rebuilt. It's a country that needs to have huge projects. We don't have a problem of resources, of money, because of the revenue of oil and gas. But again, we have a real challenge of planning, putting the strategies, implementing these plans, and having the capacity amongst the Libyans to execute these projects. So we thought it is very important for us to partner with international institutions, with NGOs such as Spark, where we have cooperation in some of our programs, to close the gap of this capacity. Our required support is expertise in entrepreneurship training. We are working on that with some of the institutions that have supported us. International expertise in post-conflict economic empowerment. Also foreign firms partnering to offer technical support to the program and direct investment in the Libyan economy, and start up SME parks, design and development. For the SMEs, it's very important to have the locations. Banks in Libya are willing to support and finance, but they need some type of guarantee. And the main guarantee they're looking for is a real asset. When there is an SME park, the projects are on the park, then they feel secure and they can give the right financing. I've been the director for this project for the last 2 years. We started as volunteers, and with many of my colleagues who were also revolutionaries and who carried arms, and who wanted to work for the country and make sure that these arms are back in depots with the army and with the police. We have had many challenges. It has not been easy, but the next coming phase with the movement of the economy and the development and with the SMEs program, and we have started our scholarship and program for higher education and vocational training. I am really hopeful that by moving the economy, we will bring security to our country. I heard a lot this morning, and I've seen some really great ideas, and here I am coming to ask for support, expertise, so anybody who can participate in this program or who is willing to give some support in expertise or in whatever possible, we'll be very happy, because we believe that the stability of Libya will bring a lot of benefit to the region, to the African neighboring countries, to Europe. Europe has a problem with migrants from Africa, illegal migrants from Africa. And I think the best way to make sure that this problem doesn't go on is to have real development in the region, Libya, and in the African countries. Thank you very much.
I'm happy that you mentioned the issue of migrants. We are really, really afraid of all those illegal immigrants going in. Bosnia is not even building a wall against Syrian refugees. Well, and meanwhile, we're not doing much, aren't we? So thank you for that statement. So who has questions to? Yeah, I see hands now. Okay, I'll go first to you.
Hi, thank you a lot for your presentation. My name is Milo Rumping. I work for Proportion. A few years ago, I've worked with former child soldiers in Colombia, and they were also involved in a project for them to make sure they would be involved in business afterwards. But I noticed a lot of some sort of hatred against these programs by the society. They were saying, hey, our children don't have jobs, sometimes we can't afford education, everything is arranged for them. I was wondering, how is it perceived by the society in Libya? And another question that's related to this one. You said there were 67,000 Tuad, the warriors, former warriors, and there were 8,000 SMEs established. Are they all working for themselves, or do you have companies and they employ people? Because perhaps if they employ people, then it's better perceived by the people in Libya. Thank you.
Thank you. We have had the same problem exactly, and this was one of the most challenging problems that we have had, is that the rest of the Libyans were saying, why? Why these two war? Why you want to provide them with opportunities? And I kept on saying, myself and my colleagues and our PR, is that you will spend billions in trying to stabilize the country on security, on disasters caused by Thuwar carrying arms, so it's better to spend these billions in developing them and developing the country, and then you can expand. This is like crisis management or disaster management. You have to do it. You cannot, when a disaster happens in a city, other cities cannot say, well, why not us? Why are we spending in this? So even though we have tried to explain, but it took so long for the society to understand. But now we had to change. Next week, probably, our name will be changed to the program, the Libyan Program for Reintegration and Development. And we will also try to absorb some other parts of society, like the jobless and so on. So it's true. And it was really for myself as a director. This was a question that keeps on coming in every interview and from everybody. Why these people? We don't want to differentiate between people. Concerning the 8,000, they will be the 8,000 will not be single projects. There will be projects where some of the projects will take 2,000, some of them 200, depending on the project. They will all have. Some of them will be employed, but in the same time, we made sure that they have shares in the projects. So they don't, they feel that this project, they are partners in the project. This is the way we went about it.
All right, one thing, by the way, I said Bosnia, I mean Bulgaria, and they also build a wall against gypsies, so they love building walls there. To have that clarified, your question.
Thank you very much. I'm Glauce Boyer from United Nations Development Programme. Thank you very much for sharing the work that you're doing with the Warriors Affairs Commission. I would like very much to hear more about how the Warriors Affairs Commission is taking into account the role that women have played in the Libya evolution, and how that their contribution is being factored also in the series of activities. I see you're taking social, political, and also economic reintegration aspects. So how are you factoring that contribution in all of your work?
This is a good question. Concerning the gender issue or the woman in the program, we concentrated on the ex-combatants, the ones who carried the arms. So we did not really have women who carried arms, but we included them in our leadership program because most of the women who participated in the revolution were either medical doctors or in the press and media, or some of them in the political side or in giving support. So most of them are included in our leadership program. But as an ex-combatants or armed ex-combatants, we don't have any woman who really carried arms. It's something that has to do with our society. Yes. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Sagizly. Thank you very much.